Welcome to the Archaeoastronomy Database. In this video, I'm going to show you how to enable some plugins for use in Stellarium that are useful for archaeoastronomy investigation, as well as for other purposes. So to enable these plugins, you go into the Configuration window and over to the Plugin tab on the far right. And then the list of plugins appears here in the left side of the window. So I'm going to select Angle Measure and then check this box to load at startup. And then I'll have to exit out of Stellarium before these will take effect. And then I'll be able to check the configuration windows and get everything set up. And then from then on, I'll be able to use these plugins in this install of Stellarium. The next plugin is ArchaeoLines. And I've already got this checked to load at startup. We're going to continue and get all of them set up so that we can go forward. The next one that I like to enable is this one to show where historical supernovas occurred in time and position in the sky. Next is Observability Analysis. And finally, Pointer Coordinates, which I've also got checked already. So I'll go ahead and close this and exit Stellarium and come back in to have those ready to configure. Okay, so when you come back into Stellarium and go back into the configuration window and the plugins tab, you should now see that the configuration button can be clicked on. And in here you can see that there are some options for the tool. But before we look at those, what the tool basically does is puts this button down in your toolbar for the angle measure and lets you click on that, which you can then use to measure the angular distance between two points in the sky or along the horizon. Now to look at some of the ways this functions, once you have the tool turned on, you can't click anywhere in the sky. You can click into Windows and advance the sky, but you can see that the angle moves with the sky, but anywhere you click in the sky will either reset the angle or draw a new one. If you turn off the tool, then you can move the sky, and you'll notice that turning the tool back on keeps the angle visible in the same place where you drew it, but if you click again, it draws a new one. There's actually two options here, and you can draw two different types of angles, or you can draw them both simultaneously. And the difference between these two is that the equatorial coordinate angle, which is in blue here, takes refraction into account, while the horizontal coordinate angle does not. And so I'll demonstrate that by turning on the azimuthal grid, which you can see has an angle measure from the horizon up to the zenith in the sky directly overhead for the local position, and azimuth divisions along the horizontal. And you can see that this line is 10 degrees off the horizontal. If we were to use both tools simultaneously, draw up to that position, you'll see that the orange number is at 10, while the blue number is significantly greater than 10. So that's because of the refraction effects. And right now they are both drawing exactly in the same position, and they move if you change the view or advance the sky. But by selecting or unselecting these two options, the horizontal coordinate angle will actually stay in position. And so, depending on your usage, it will stay fixed into that position that you place even when the sky rotates. sometimes I use that tool not for measuring angles, but just to create a quick and temporary marker on the horizon for a rising and setting point that will then stay in place, just like putting up a post on the horizon. For now, I'll just leave it into this default mode that I usually use to measure a quick angle that includes refraction. All right, going on to the next plugin. This is the one that is extremely useful for archaeoastronomy investigation, which in itself is an understatement. I use it all the time. So this also places a button in the toolbar down here, you can see, for ArchaeoLines. And when you click on ArchaeoLines, you will get these lines tracing across the sky, showing the rising and setting and the path of travel in the sky for the sun and the moon at various significant astronomical positions. So for example, you can see that the equinox line is marked here. At the west is where it sets, and it arcs under and over the sky to come back up in the east. So there is a button for configuration, and this is where you can choose which lines to display and also what colors they'll display at. Of course, I have a color scheme that I use for almost all my investigations just to keep everything coordinated. You can also display the path of a particular planet, and you can display the current sun or current moon, and also a line for any selected object. So that includes a star or a planet that you just select instead of using the selection here. You can also get an azimuth line that draws to the object so that as it moves, that azimuth line will continue along the horizon, tracing straight back down. And of course, hour angle as well. So you also have custom lines that you can either put in a longitude and latitude to draw a line to a specific point on the map. It will show the exact angle on the horizon, so the azimuth, towards another location from the location that you're viewing at. And you can also set up two custom azimuths, which will just put vertical lines at that azimuth. You can see here to the side, and you can also draw two custom altitudes like I'm showing here. Can be toggle off any of these, and then you've got your custom declination. So even though we're at a modern date, and you can see this solstice line right here, and the sun happens to be right on the solstice line because it's so close to the solstice now. But if we were to advance off a few days, you can see the sun is moving off that line. But I have marked here a custom of negative 24 degrees for this green line, keeping the Neolithic winter solstice in position. If I were to go back in time to the Neolithic, then that orange line would be overlaid with the green line. And so I wouldn't actually need the custom anymore. That's for comparison with modern dates. But here you can just use the solstice line of that particular time period. There is so much more that I could talk about with this tool that I'd really need a whole nother video to do it. So we'll leave it at that for right now and toggle the lines back off. The next tool is Historical Supernova, and you don't really have to configure much with this tool. It just, from time to time, could get updates for new information, but mostly I'm using this to look at past supernova that have happened in the distant past. And so, for example, I could go to the year 1054 to about July 4th, and just as the sun is not quite above the horizon, you can see bright supernova SN 1054 right here, and this is in the constellation of Taurus, the bull. And this supernova, if I back it up even just 1 month, you'll see it's no longer there. And if I go forward, you can see that it lasted for many, many months, quite bright in the sky, outshining every other object other than the sun. And then, as time continues to advance, you can see it's starting to fade. It's brighter here. And then it dims completely to just a normal star for a while, and then a very faint star, until it's no longer visible to the naked eye in the months to follow. So now that you've enabled that plugin, you'll be able to see these supernova whenever you go to the correct time. And then it's also nice that they'll draw your attention even if they're not selected by labeling the supernova. Okay, moving back to our next tool, we have the Observability Analysis tool. This tool also places a button in the toolbar here, and when you select a particular object, such as a star, and turn this on, you get some data for the largest sun separation, nights above the horizon, and especially the achronical and cosmical and heliacal rise and set dates for that particular object in that particular location at that particular time period. Now, the achronical rise and set and cosmical rise and set are sometimes a bit confusing in terms, but what they mean is that if you go to the date that's listed, for example, December 26th, you'll see that right when this star is on the horizon, rising, the sun is setting on the horizon. And that also applies, for example, if we go to June 30th, you'll see that both the star and the sun are rising together. Now, these are not actually observable times to see the star because the sun is on the horizon with them. So it's the heliacal rise that is when the star would actually be visible. And even this date can sometimes be a little difficult to determine because it all has to do with atmospheric conditions and the brightness of the star and how high above the horizon it can even be visible at all due to extinction. And so Stellarium, with this plugin, is really just calculating it in a fairly simple way. So the on-the-horizon calculations, of course, just match when the sun's on the horizon and the star's on the horizon, either rising or setting, depending on which one. But if you go into the configuration, you can see that the way that this is being calculated is simply when the sun's, for the heliacal rising and setting, is when the sun is 12 degrees below the horizon. So if we were to go to April 25th, and this is the heliacal set, so we'll move the star down to the horizon. and you can see that the sun, if we click on it, is 12 degrees below the horizon. And so that is how that is calculated. And in the configuration for this tool, you can actually adjust that if you would like the star to be rising or setting with the sun a little further below the horizon for the dates that are given in the tool. You can also choose which of the information in this display, if there's some that you're not interested in at the moment, so it doesn't clutter up the display. And then you can also adjust the horizon itself to change whether the star is exactly on the horizon with the sun or slightly higher. And then, of course, you can change the font color by adjusting these sliders. Now, there's a lot more I could talk about as far as even how the observable risings and settings, first appearances and last appearances of stars work. And that would take another video as well. But this tool can at least give you a baseline to get started with. The next tool is the plugin for the pointer coordinates. This is a fairly simple tool, again with an icon that appears down here. And when you select this, you'll actually get coordinates you can see displaying up here. If I stop the sky from moving, the coordinates are connected to where I place my mouse. But I like to go into the configuration, and you can choose where the coordinates appear. I usually like to have them in the bottom right corner of the screen. And then you can choose what sort of coordinates you want to display. I, most of the time, will use the azimuth or altitude just to instantly know where that is in the sky. And even more common than that, I just use right ascension and declination. And be sure that you choose this one instead of J2000, which doesn't change as you change the year. This one will change with the year. And there are other options as well. So you can see that wherever I move my mouse pointer to, I'll have the coordinates in both right ascension and declination displaying. And there are a couple of other things that you can do as well, like change the font size, and you can show crossed lines so you can find a certain declination and what's directly below it, tracing down that line to the horizon. And of course, you could check this box so that they are automatically turned on when you start up instead of having to click the button. So that's all for the plugins that I wanted to show in this video. Thank you for watching. Please like, subscribe, and share so that others can find out about the Archaeoastronomy Database. And I'd like to thank those that have been able to donate or become patrons on Patreon. That really helps me to be able to do the work of the Archaeoastronomy Database. If you would consider a one-time donation on PayPal or becoming a patron on Patreon, at whichever level you feel comfortable with, that would really help the work to move forward at a greater pace. Thank you for your interest and your support.